The year is 1864. Confederate soldiers at the Union Army Prisoner of War Camp, Camp Douglas, are near starving to death. Malnourished soldiers cry out in the night. Some of them protest. Others attempt to escape the horrid living conditions they've been subjected to. 17% of the thousands of Confederate soldiers that are imprisoned there will die there, and many others will be subjected to torture. That particular torture was an updated version of something created by the Spanish in the 17th century. The Spanish called it the donkey, but the Americans gave it the name the mule. Those soldiers condemned to take a ride on the mule were told they must ride the rail until they could take no more. These were the actual words from one Confederate POW. This performance was carried on under the eyes of a guard with a loaded gun and was kept up for several days, each ride lasting 2 hours each day unless the fellow fainted and fell off from pain and exhaustion. Many men wouldn't ever walk again. They were ruined on the rail, disabled, broken, crippled for life. We'll get back to when this horrific kind of punishment was used in the United States later. First, let's take a look at how the Spanish did things. The torture is best known as the Spanish donkey, but it seems this instrument of torture was used all over Europe. The French had a similar device and they called it the chevalet, which comes from the French word for horse. But perhaps the best name for the device was the Italian name. That was the cavalletto squarciapale. The writer didn't speak Italian, so he put that into Google Italian to English translate, and the translation was ball breaker stand. So we have mule, horse, donkey, and ball breaker. From what we can see, they all look pretty much the same. The device looks similar to a horse used in gymnastics, but instead of having a flat saddle-like seat, the top of the horse is triangular and so very, very uncomfortable to sit on. In Europe, to make things worse, the torturers would sometimes embed spikes into the top of the triangular prism, and often the person who was being punished was naked. As you can imagine, this was incredibly painful for both men and women. If that wasn't bad enough, often the person would be fastened to the sharp seat and given something very heavy to hold. That, or they would have weights fastened to their legs. As you'll soon see, the Americans had a very unique way of weighing the person down. So let's say a guy or a gal lived in the Middle Ages in Europe and they were not exactly enamored with the Catholic Church. Those people might be arrested by the authorities and charged with heresy, but those authorities would want to know where more of those despicable heretics were hiding. As you know, back then, human rights weren't exactly in place when a person was brought in for questioning. The questioning, by the way, was part of something called the Holy Inquisition. The Inquisition started in France in the 12th century, and that later morphed into the Roman Inquisition and the Portuguese Inquisition, and then, of course, the one you've all heard of, the Spanish Inquisition. Wherever there was Catholicism, there were Inquisitions, and thousands of people went on trial throughout the Middle Ages. The outcome for being charged with heresy was not very good for the accused. Depending on the location, the accused might first be tortured and then burned at the stake. Believe it or not, the English usually only ripped men limb from limb and eviscerated them after hanging. Female heretics, say some of the people accused of being witches or those denying the existence of God, were burned. Men were also burned, and hanging and drawn and quartering were usually reserved for people accused of treason. Okay, so back to the horse. Let's say a person was being tortured on one of those things, but they weren't giving up any names. As you now know, weights might be tied to their legs, but the torturers had more depravity up their sleeves. Sometimes the inquisitors would tickle the person's feet, which wasn't exactly funny for the victim, and that's because they'd wriggle around on that sharp seat. If tickling didn't work, the inquisitors might burn the person's feet, and that definitely got them moving. What was the outcome of this? Well, as you can imagine, it caused significant damage to the genital area. If the person survived, they would likely not be making or having any kids in the future. But there was worse. If they rode the donkey long enough, the perineum, the area between the anus and the genitals, could rupture. This would cause unimaginable pain, and the subsequent blood loss could kill a person. Riding that donkey could also cause something called the sacrum to break. That's the triangular-shaped bone at the end of the spine. If it broke during the torture, that person would likely not have walked again. If more weight was added to the legs, the horse could even partly split a person down the middle, and that could lead to a quick death. It wasn't always that bad, though. We found one case where a Danish man in 1668 was forced to ride the horse, but only for 90 minutes. From what we can see, he survived the ordeal and walked away from it with his sacrum intact. According to the state archives in Copenhagen, he'd been punished for sending fireworks into the sky on New Year's Day. But what about when the soldiers in the Confederate Army rode the Union mule? How did it work out for them? Well, thanks to the writing of a Confederate soldier and a prisoner of war, one Milton Asbury Ryan of the 8th MS Regiment, we know that riding the mule could disable a man. In his diaries, Ryan wrote, Very few were able to walk after this hellish Yankee torture, but had to be supported to their barracks. A book on the American Civil War tells us that another nickname for the mule was Morgan's Mule. This was a little different from the triangular Spanish donkey, in that the men were forced to sit on a 2x4 piece of wood that was suspended in the air. Soldiers might have had the weight strapped to their legs, but as we said at the start, the Union soldiers would sometimes weigh the man down with something quite unusual. Those weights were large beef bones, which would be strapped to the man's hands. They'd sit on the thin side of the plank, of course, and then be rocked back and forth until enough damage had been caused. Some men couldn't handle it and would just pass out and have to be taken down. Some of those men would be disabled for life. It was called Morgan's Mule after a famous Confederate general named John H. Morgan. This was not out of respect, but it was supposed to be sardonic humor in that the Confederate prisoners got to ride this great general's horse. And it hurt. A lot. Now go watch this show, Worst Punishments in the History of Mankind. Or take a look at this, Worst Punishments in the History of Mankind, even worse than before.